Welcome to Black Beat Podcast, where we take an unapologetically Black approach to profiling people and stories that are significant to the connectivity and advancement of our community. I'm John Washington. I'm the CEO and Editor-in-Chief of Flossom Media, your host for each Black Beat episode. Today, we are honored to welcome musical legend Michael Greene, a.k.a. Easy McCoy, to the show. This hip-hop lyricist was raised on the mean streets of Seattle, Yesler, Terrace neighborhood. Easy McCoy has spent over two decades writing, publishing, performing, and producing his music. His new endeavor, Entity Music Group, is focused on helping young artists seeking to forge pathways in the music industry and give them opportunities to sign with the label. Welcome, Mr. McCoy. I've been looking forward to this interview. We go way back, B, and this is like, what a joy. Now, as we was talking about this, now I would really like to be doing this in the evening, but we understand the importance of the business side of what it is that you do. So, but tell us a little bit, man, welcome to the show today, my brother, man.
Thank you.
Talk to us a little bit about how you got to where you is, man, and how you get here. Tell us about your journey, man, a little bit today. And share with us a little bit about Mr. Michael's story.
Well, you know, I mean, you know, like a lot of young Black males, you know, grew up in the inner city, came up having to really believe in myself. You know, it wasn't the right circumstances by any means necessary. But by any means necessary, I made it happen for myself with no excuses. You know, raised in Seattle. You know, it like I said, it was a typical inner city. You know, mother wasn't around. Father wasn't around, you know, and obviously, like, with that, when you raised in the inner city, you know, gangs is a part of your culture, but also music is a big part of the culture, you know. Hip hop is a big part of the culture, and that was something that I feel like at a young age, before I knew I would be here, when I was rapping on the corners and freestyling in my homeboy's beatbox, and I really felt like that was some type of voice, because, you know, being raised in the city, a lot of people don't listen to your story. They don't really want to listen to you. But when you start rapping, they pay attention. So I was like, hey, you know what? I can actually shed some light to tell my story, rather it was in a negative way or a positive way. Back then, it was real negative. But that's all I seen was negativity. So I had nothing really positive for me to talk about. So I used that as a voice, as a way to, you know, share my story. And obviously, through that, being in the street led to being locked up, gang stuff, you know, all of that stuff that comes with it without having a father in your home that was raising you right, or like a constant somebody pulling you to do what's right. When you have all the negative things of the street, obviously that led to being locked up and moving to Portland and doing different things like that. But with that being said, that led to me finding who I was and leading me to get into the music industry for doing it 20 years. And being able to share my story in all the ups and downs of the music industry, like, you know, bad record deals, good record deals, bad tours, good tours, no money, make some money, being in the red for a long time, you know, kind of, you know, just trying to figure it out.
Yeah, man.
But, you know, but the one thing, like they say, man, the one thing what I didn't do is I didn't give up. I think that's a simple factor that you hear people say, but it's very necessary for you to do, you know.
Staying on the track, right? Staying committed, staying tenacious.
Staying committed.
But tell me this, man. It's a little bit of knowing you in the past, man. There was something about you was on a Christian label, man. How'd you get to something like that? Was that true? Was there ever an issue?
Yeah.
Christian label, man. How'd you get from the mean streets to understand a little bit more about God?
Right. I was. It was a company called Beatmar Recorders. Now, understand, like, my music before that, I had a very, like, for me, I never looked at myself like a Christian rapper. You don't really hear dudes say Muslim rapper. You don't hear people say, oh, that's a Muslim rapper or that's a Hindu rapper. I was just, you know what I mean? Like, I was just speaking my faith through my music, and I got a record deal. But with that record deal, I realized, oh, I could be in a positive light. It was cool. It was the worst deal I did ever, though, to be honest. Even in that market, it was still the music business. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was still the music business. And like I said, the people was cool, but, like, once again, the music, but everybody ain't your friend in business. But I got that situation. It showed me a lot. It taught me a lot about the music business. And the reason why I really wasn't on the level, on the label no more, in my opinion, my Jesus count wasn't high enough. They want you to say Jesus all the time. But then it becomes fake. You know what I'm saying? It's like you're trying to control me. You're trying to control what I say, how I say it. And me coming from where I come from, I knew that wasn't going to hit the people I was trying to reach right. And so once again, with that control, I had to get loose of that control and just felt like I just want to do music. I don't want to be pigeonholed like, oh, you're a Christian artist or you're this. Look, man, I'm an artist. Period. That's what I do. And I share my story. When you're an artist, whether you're painting, writing, breakdancing, anything that you're dancing, because dancing is art. We're all telling a story.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So for me, it's like, what story do I choose to tell y'all? So if Christ, if I'm talking about Christ, Yahweh, God, or whatever, that's a part of my story. Everything ain't negative. Everything ain't gun, gun, bang, bang. There's family, like there's real structure there that us, even to me as a Black artist, I definitely want to be able to share that. Because all that, and you know, how you know with the game, a lot of people lie anyway, so I chose not to lie.
Yeah.
I chose not to lie in my music.
But you know, McCoy, it's been fascinating watching your maturity, man, and as you grow through your life and right. go through all of that, man, and all the changes and the growth, man. But I hear now that you really focusing on your wellness and yourself and your health, man. Tell us a little bit about that fitness endeavor, man. I mean, you came from little guy to the big guy.
I mean, I think, you know, some for anybody, for any man, for any woman, health and discipline is a big part. And it translates over to your business, it'll translate over to your relationships, it'll translate over the way you handle your money and the people in your life. Like, and it ain't got to be like me doing 1,000 pushups, like, you know, with my workout, but whatever thing that you're disciplined that you got to keep going. I think that's very important. Changing diets, changing habits. I'm not perfect by any means, but I'm learning, like, yo, strive to do something different that you've never done to see what you can get from it. So whether I'm waking up at 5 a.m. every day to work out, that's what I'm doing. Whether I'm running, whether I'm writing rhymes all day, all of those things, whether I'm choosing what I put in my body, being like a 45-50% vegan, but yes. trying to get to 100%. But yeah. it's like being aware, being conscious of the God body we got. That's important to me. Like before, I wasn't conscious of that. Now I'm doing my best every day to be conscious of that.
Wow. So it sounds to me like, so peak performance is pretty much so everything that you look at that you want to be really good at.
Yes.
You're saying you got to stay committed to the game, stay yep. true to what it is that you do.
Yeah.
And most importantly, you got to commit to a higher form of growth on a daily basis.
Every day.
Reaching for the stars. Huh? Wow, man. I mean, but what a commitment there'll be. I mean, so what, how has that been since now that you, I mean, your little family, you know, you got family going on, you got business going on.
Right.
Tell me, man, is that all part of it for you in the day's reality for you to be able to stay on your peak performance and your highest pitch of your game?
Yeah, that's definitely a part of the motivation of, you know what I'm saying, of what I do, the family structure. And just so just as a young Black man, even as a Black hip hop artist, though, that family's important. Like that, you know, that everything ain't about, you know, being the biggest player or doing all that, like what they really taught us, you know what I mean? Because if you look at the game, yeah, they taught us that. But if you look at the game, everybody's successful, any successful entrepreneur or even big artists, they got a family, they got a structure. I think they're filming this one. It's the structure, you know what I mean? Like the structure of family is very, very important. And I think that boils over to my discipline, because I'm not wasting time. I'm not out doing stupid stuff, wasting money. Like I got a certain, you know, my son got to do his homework. I got a new baby on the way. I got to make sure certain things are in order. But with that, it comes an incredible focus. So like for me, like when I get up at 5 a.m., my determination for that is like when I look and see, you know, my fiance peacefully, my kids peacefully, that's the motivation for me to get up and keep going. They know they can depend on me to do everything that I need to do in my life. Like and that's important when you call yourself a king.
They I'm know trying to tell you, real McCoy. That's the real McCoy.
Yeah, you got this castle, man. You know, I mean, the king got to be up before everybody, man. The king don't sleep in. King work late, get up early. He's the one that they know. Yo, the king is He know how to fight. He trained. He the best. You know what I'm saying? To run a kingdom, you got to be, you know, the best at that on your throne. Can't no, and then you're going to get the throne. And ain't nobody dethroning me off my throne. Dethroning me off my throne. Nah.
So McCoy, tell us a little bit though about them highs and lows, man. I mean, you know, tell our viewers a little bit, man, about this game. I mean, it ain't been always roses. I mean, you know, share with us a little bit about what them highs and lows was like. I mean, what's been... contrasted today, you know, compared to where you was at your lows and to your highs. I mean, what's that experience been like for you in the transition?
Well, you know, now that I kept going, and it's the idea, like, when you keep going, them lows, I appreciate them a lot more. Like David Goggins, I hear him talk about going in your cookie jar. So I started to start looking like, man, I've been through this. You know what I'm saying? I've been moments, man, where I've sat in my home not knowing what I'm going to do with my life. When I lost two homes and, you know, I was trying to, you know, deal with my children, couldn't see them. A lot of, and at the same time, trying to do music. I mean, from the tank deal to doing them videos and, you know, things not working out. I think the lows really lift you up when you understand what, you know, the reason for them. Because I feel like that's just like a test of life. Oh, we're just going to keep throwing bricks at you, see if you quit. You know what I mean? Like to see, yeah, I'm going to see. Because really, that I think that's the definition of getting to success. It's like a simple thing, never quitting. Just like, all right, I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep walking, no matter how hard this get. And when that's why, even for me, like I said, like I do 1,000 push-ups. I like the beginning of that. It's the hardest moment, the beginning of doing the push-ups. But when I'm at like 700 to 800, oh, it's just flow. Because I broke through. You know what I mean? It's about breaking through. You got to break through. And break through them lows. And when you got them lows, you appreciate the highs a lot more. And I noticed that in myself. It ain't even something like it's just something slick I say. Like you really can look back and be like, ooh, I did that? Oh, I know what else I can do if I got through that. Like I've been through this and been through all of this BS. Oh, man, what's in front of me ain't nothing. You see what I've been through?
Yeah.
So now my perspective is different on struggles because I embrace them a lot more.
Yeah, you're still standing.
Yeah.
And that's real important, you know, McCoy, because whenever I think about what resurrection means, you know, and as a former ball player, man, it's like, you know, you get hit, you know, and in life we take them hits, you know, and we go down. And sometimes, man, them hits be hard, boy. And sometimes you be laying down and you be asking yourself, shit, do I really want to stand up again?
Sure. No,
but
for
the
sure.
True notion of that resurrection is about standing up, man. And, you know, and only true grit in those people, as you talk about, you know, making it and stay on the road long enough, you understand that meaning of commitment, you know. And it's just not a passive word that somebody give you and you just blow it off. Because commitment starts with yourself. If you can't commit to yourself, then what good is you, right? So yeah, tell me, so Pete, you work with these young people now, man. I mean, so tell me, man, how's the trend of music going these days? I mean, what is out there for these young people, man, that is different from you for you back in the day in the game, coming in the game? What are you exposing, or what are young people being exposed to in the game today that's different?
Well, you know, for me, my lane, you know, I feel like one thing I've been learning how to focus for the past few is my lane. What I'm doing, it's TV, doing music for television. You know, everybody who don't watch TV, everybody watch TV. It's the main source from Instagram, YouTube, all of these things. For me, years ago, I understood when I watch TV, there's always music. Somebody's paying for that. Somebody got to pay somebody to use these songs. You know, so when I learned that 15 years ago, it's something that I dug into, which I feel like for these young kids, since I'm so much established in the market, I want to open up doors for these young kids to be able to get deals on their own, not sell their soul, and be able to make money to whatever they, you know, for their families, for their college or whatever. But you can do it by getting music on TV and you have more control over your career, because people understand. I cracked the code to understand that, like, yo, it's a better way to hustle in the music game. Like, you don't actually got to tour. You don't actually all the time got to tour. And you don't got to, like, sell your soul. Like, you don't got to give up all your rights. You don't got to, like, you know, do things where you be mad at the music. You know how many people I know that's mad at the music industry for bad decisions? I was too, until I figured out, okay, I ain't finna get mad at y'all. I'm finna get ahead. So I'm gonna figure out how to get into the game a different way. And I came through the right door, you know, and then I kicked that joint in. But when I kicked it in, I had the results to say, yo, what I'm doing to fix this door, don't worry about the door. You got a prize sitting right in front of you. And I was able to negotiate, after all the work that I put in, better deals. So now with these young kids I want to help, when I walk through the door in the game, I feel like it's like Jay-Z walking in the game because they know what I bring to the table.
Yeah.
And you know, if I got a young brother with me or a young sister with me who do music or a producer, they're official because I ain't riding with nobody who ain't official. So that's what I'm trying to do, is open up another way for these artists to be able to tell stories with other stories. You understand? When people telling you to talk about redemption, like I did a song called that, and it was about redemption for a show. And man, it came from the heart because I really talked about what it means to be redeemed, coming from the bottom, not like necessarily in the like westernized Christian way, that corny way. I think it's corny. Yeah. I'm talking about really redeeming yourself with your faith in God and your faith in yourself to come up from the bottom when they thought you were nothing. So it's like being able to create these things and then help these young artists get in and at the end of the day, get paid for it too. You actually get, you know, because it's not enough. Like, I don't want to be the artist trying to help an artist out and not paying. You got to get some money, man. Yeah, if your craft is worth something, let me get you paid at the same time if you're willing to put the work in, you know? That's what I want to offer to the young ones.
Where that fire and drive coming from? So, you know, McCoy, what is that inside of you, man? I mean, damn, boy, I mean, if you had the ball in your hand, boy, you sound like you'd be a contender. You,
come on now. You know, come on now.
Where's that fire coming from as a youngster, man? I mean,
listen, I'm still alive, though. Think about this. I'm still alive, man. I'm happy. That's where that fire comes from, because I came from nothing, though, to be in this position, to look at my life and be like, yo, you really made it. Like you really done something different. And I was like, you know what? Now I'm just getting started. So that fire come from me never want to be poor again. Never want my kids to go through certain things that I went through in my life. Never wanting my, you know, like wanting to be there, wanting to be a shoulder for my family to lean on, you know, because I didn't have none of that. Like, wasn't, you know, I used to get embarrassed as a kid, talk bad to people, eat in front of my face. Like a lot of those things I started dealing with as I got older, like, yo, people used to talk bad to me, everything. And now that I made it here, it's like, all I want to do is do the opposite. You know what I'm saying? Help the youngins out. And that's why my tenacity is different. And can't nobody tell me different. My faith in God is elite. You know what I mean? And what can you tell me that I can't do? Because I know where my mind is. Come on, man. I don't care if you got me. I don't care.
Pretty sure, boy, this morning. You got a special glow. I'll tell you that, though, man.
Come on, man. I want everybody to have that, though, when you get around me. I want you to be like, you know what? It's a long shot, but I believe I can do it.
Yeah, you know, and McCoy, and that's a blessing, bro. You know, and with a new child on the way and everything, man, I am so blessed to have this opportunity to spend this with you this morning. So tell us about the new group, man, Entity.
The Entity
group, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, tell us a little bit about it, man. How was it formed? What y'all doing with it? Where you going with it?
Well, what I want to do with this team when I started the Entity Music Group, once again, it was to help artists out. I've seen so many artists get robbed. I mean, so many artists not get opportunities. I've seen talented artists be depressed because they put in so much work and nothing's ever happened. So for me, with me and my team, from the publishers I work with, from the sync teams I work with, we created a formula where, you know, you could really help these artists and not rob them. Like, we don't want to rob you. We don't want to, because we know how much money's involved in sync. We know how much money's involved in television. I mean, it's like a $190 billion industry that they're just spending for promote. Like, you know, we want, man, we could touch 10% of that. We changing lives. Like, touch 1% of that, you changing lives. So the whole idea with the Entity was build an entity of people, a group of people to work together, you know, and create opportunities for these younger artists. For artists in general, though, I mean, you know, it don't really matter. You could be young or old. Like, if there's a position that we could do and you're serious, and I believe in it, you know, because you got to believe in it. You can't come to me like, well, you know, I think I can do it. Well, I don't want to talk to you. Yeah. You know, like, if you know you can do it and you got to believe in your system, we can get it done. You over here talking, well, I don't know. Yeah, why? When you figure it out, come holler at me and then I'll see. You know what I'm saying? But, that's like the goal with Entity Music Group, is to give people fair deals, fair opportunities, and knowing that I could be a part of the process for them to create some great music, and we ain't leaving them hanging. And it's just opening the door for partnerships to be able to collab, because, you know, it's no right that it's not right. I feel like these big companies, man, just to, you know, they building homes off the back of these artists while these artists is apartments and they struggling for a little bit of nothing, man, because, you know, they're creators and they're not businessmen. A lot of creatives just want to create. So the fault they make is they take whatever little thing that they can get to create and not think about the future. And before you know it, you got somebody building a mansion off your work ethic, you know, off your work and your gift, because you're creative and you know the business side. So we want to, you know, teach the business side too. You know what I mean? So they know the value they have, you know what I mean, as artists.
You know, when we look at the history of the game, you know, with LL Cool J and all them starting out and all that.
Right.
And when we looked at how the Jew boys used to control the market back in the day. And then when we looked at how they moved the junk into the trunk, you know, when cats was mixing in the basement and, you know, and slinging them joints. And you remember when we used to have a garage full of CDs, right? And get out there on the block and have to move that. And then it went to the digital distribution side of that. What are you seeing out there these days that's changing in the industry now? So, P, is there another level after that that has occurred? You know, because that's where I got off at the digital distribution side. But what's going on out there now is different.
I'm going to say, though, with this whole digital era, it's definitely for artists who are smart, it's easy to get in because you can create from home. You know, it's so many ways of making it easy for every artist to get paid through DistroKid. You could separate the payments, streaming, you know, people always on our phone listening, you know, to music. And, you know, when we talk the digital age, the whole cryptocurrency, like what that's doing right now and how that's even infiltrating music with the NFTs and art and creativity, it's kind of like the internet boom. Anybody involved in being smart artist-wise from art, drawing, just businesses, you know, you could be capitalized. I mean, even by the end of the year or next year, you know how many millionaires is going to be made off of people who have invested or they're doing like NFTs with the music and learning how to do that, the non-fungible tokens, how to doing that. I mean, it's actually like sky's the limit. You just got to study. But like I said, we're in the digital age, like with the movies and everything, how they're doing that with TV and, you know, running to Netflix and needing music for everything. It's so easy to do it. If you work hard and you know the right people, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's not, it's the lane is wide open. Lane is wide open for artists.
So tell me about the new album there, Sophie. I mean, McCoy, tell me what's that? What's tell me, I Am Legend. You know, I hear something about this. Tell me a little bit about that.
I got so much. The funny thing is like, so the thing, I got so many projects coming out, like singles, stuff with ESPN, stuff with, I mean, Nike, like everything. I think like I got a project next week coming out with my man Chuck Norris on North Star Media, May 26th. Then I got another project coming out like on a Friday, a single coming out May 31st. Then I got a project coming out, March 31st, March 26th. Then March 20, I think like 29th, something else is coming out. I got a project with Position Music coming out April 2nd. This is what I'm gonna say. When it comes to syncing what I do,
right,
I'm non-exclusive, so nobody owns rights to just me. Every deal that I do, I can do it with any other company on different terms, which just gave me leverage. So I could do most, and me being a creative, I'm such a beast, I know how to flip styles a lot. Everything's not sounding the same. So I can work with Chuck Norris on a project, then I work on my man Ozzy on a project, I work on my man B. Jones, my man Xander, my man Cairo, like all these different people, and plus Black Hydra, all these different groups, and everybody do something different when it comes to TV and television. And I got all different companies representing these different albums where not one company has the same album. And that was a strategy I did for one, to be able to diversify my portfolio with all these different companies, treating it like stocks. And another is to create a revenue stream on the back end. Just damn, like every month I get a check now.
Right.
Just because I created this formula for the past couple of years, and I put a lot of work in. You know what I mean? And I never forsake the work, the trips to Cali, the trips to Vegas, the recording back and forth, doing the work. That's like very monumental with it all. So for me, I got a whole bunch of stuff coming out. Like I said, I treat the game like these signs are like stocks to me right now.
Yeah. So you're building that brand. You know, the other day I was listening to Kevin Hart and them on their station, man, and they was kicking it around a little bit like how we kicking it around right now on some topics. And one of them topics that came up, McCoy, was this issue around the pandemic and how the music, how it is changing somewhat the lay of the land in the music game, you know, because y'all out there, y'all make your money by other than cats like you who got a little bit smarter on how to approach this industry. But they're making their money out there, you know, in front of people, right? But now the pandemic won't let them get in front of people that you don't necessarily in the audience capacity. How has the pandemic changed your game? You know, or has it influenced you, your situation in any kind of way?
The best thing, I mean, it was one of the best years I had, you know, when it came to because I was, nobody was doing that. So I was recording a lot, going to studio sessions, you know, one-on-one sessions, and all the movies was going because everybody was at home. So for me, they was like, we need songs for this, we need songs for that, we need songs for this. Because everybody was watching TV. So for me, but the other part is I put the work in too, though. I was creative. I was doing what needed to be done, you know, at the time to get it done, you know. So for me, in my craft, it affected me in a great way. You know what I mean? But once again, I was willing to put the work in.
That's the deal. And so the theme throughout your message today to me, man, is you got to get up and do the thousand, you know, and start with the hardest part of it first and stay on the game, you know, and stay in the game, you know.
You got to have tough skin, though, man. What you saw, you ain't going to be the greatest being soft, period.
No, man, they understand that. I think them other people understand that word called grit, you know. And you ain't got grit, and if you ain't got that ability to stick to something, man, and stay engaged, and you might as well don't even get on the track, you know, because it's stay in the bleachers, you know, because they're hungry people out there on that track, man. And then cats like you, you know, because you could be a person's worst nightmare. You run into you in the alleyway,
right?
You know what I'm saying? You know?
For sure.
You know, sure. It ain't about no fakeness on that game, man. Hey, but right. So tell me about McCoy. So tell me, man, what is it that you want people, them young artists out there and our listeners today? I mean, at a small caption. What is it that you would like to share with them, man? And from your heart to these young cats and gals that are out there, you know they struggle, you know, and what is it that you want to let them know, man, that's the core of your message to them out there today? What is it that you can sum up and share with them that you want them to know about this game?
I'm going to tell you something off top. Stop wasting time. Stop wasting time waiting around for somebody to do it for you. And build solid relationships. Don't step on nobody. You might need them 20 years from now. It might be the catapult to why you as big as who you are. Make sure you mend in relationships. Stop wasting time. And when I say stop wasting time, like study what you want to do. Like, you know, that's what I had to put down my phone sometime and wake up and study the game. Whatever you're going to do, think about any ball player, football player, anybody, what they say, they study tapes for hours. They study the game, learn the game. Learn the business and stop wasting time. You ain't going to do it on your phone. Scrolling, you're not going to, like, that's a young generation thing. You're not going to do it. Put that joint away and put the work in and don't give up. And I know it sounds like, oh, everybody say don't give up. But, man, like, that's, like, true. Just, like, if you're really going to keep going, I feel like things, the universe and God, however you want to say it, works around those who don't give up. I ain't never seen nobody who didn't give up and really believed in themselves not achieve. Yeah. Some of y'all really don't. Hey, listen, I want to say one more thing. Some of y'all really don't believe. If you really believe, you're going to put the work in every day.
Woo, boy.
Period. Faith without works is dead. Like they say, faith without works is dead. So how you say you believe in something?
Stop that bomb, boy. That's a bomb there. You know.
If you really believe in something, you're going to do it. You're going to put your money where your mouth is, your time where your mouth is. All of that. You're going to say, nah, I believe this will work. You know what I'm saying? Like, I believe it. This will work. I mean, you know, and so that's like that tenacity of believing and stop letting people tell you what you ain't when you know what you are, if you really know that.
Like, you know, man, something has just grabbed me in my stomach, man. And I usually don't ask these three questions, man, of a cat when I'm doing these interviews with them. But something about your clarity, man, makes it prompting me to ask these questions, these three questions. And they're very basic. Just give me an instant response to them when you hear me ask it.
Who?
Speak to me about love.
Unconditional.
Speak to me about death.
Inevitable.
Speak to me about life.
Man, you gotta live it. You gotta live it and enjoy it. You know what I mean? Don't worry. Don't worry. I've learned the past. I try not to worry. I do my best because I still deal with worry. Don't get me wrong. But man, the more carefree I be and let life flow, not carefree as in sloppy, but just carefree to be like, you know what? I know what's for me is for me.
Man, McCoy, thank you for this morning, my brother. You sent me, you know, in a very interesting space this morning, man. And I am so honored and grateful to have this interview and this time with you this morning. Yes,
sir. Okay. Appreciate it.
And thank you for being part of this show. We take pride in improving people's perceptions of capabilities, significance, and influence in their lives and in the lives of others in their community. Hey, my brother, this has been a wake-up call, man. And for anybody who's listening, who's going to listen to this here, y'all need to hear what this brother got to say. Stay on the track. If you ain't on the track, then go home and sit on the porch. But just get out the way of those who are running serious on the game, you know,
because if you stand
in the way, somebody's going to run right up your back. You know what I'm saying? So get
out. You're going to get hurt.
You're going to get hurt. So my brother, man, it is really good to see you forge ahead in your career, man. And we will always keep an eye on you. Hey, McCoy, share with our audience, man, how to get a hold of you, man, for those who want to reach you, man, and want to stay in connection with you and get involved with your game, man. How could they reach you, man?
Everything is at Easy McCoy on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. And my email is easymccoy@gmail.com. I mean, it's easy. It's very easy to remember. You know the name, you can find me wherever I'm at.
You know the name, Mr. McCoy himself, the real McCoy, y'all. Hey, man, good morning. And my brother, man, it was a pleasure. Until next time, hey, man, you have a great, wonderful life. You hear me?
Respect. Thank you.
Yeah, Shante.
Take it away, take it away, feeling too good to me. Chilling all day, all in your space is where I wanna be. Here in this room, what did you do? I just can't get enough. Too caught up in your love.